Use Your Illusion 2 is my favorite Guns N' Roses album. Whoa! Yeah, yeah, like I said before, I can hear that Appetite's their best, but Use Your Illusion 2 is my favorite. And I only admitted that now. Yeah, I never admitted that out loud before. But yeah, it has its flaws, and in fact, there's one song here that might be the worst Guns N' Roses song ever. I mean, unless you count Chinese Democracy as Guns N' Roses, which I don't. Yeah, it features their worst song. But overall, I really love this album, and I think it's better than Use Your Illusion 1. More consistent, darker, and to me, the ballads and the epics, for the most part, all work on this album. This album just has a vibe to it. It's the darkest and most sophisticated thing that ever came out of these guys. And I loved it then, too. As a kid, this was my favorite. I like Use Your Illusion 1 more as a kid than I do now. But I always liked 2 the best. 2 was always my favorite. And of course, I was excited about Use Your Illusion 2 because I already knew 2 songs on it I loved. I already loved Civil War and You Could Be Mine, which were on this one. So going into it, whereas Use Your Illusion 1, all I knew was Don't Cry, and I wasn't crazy about that version. And The Live and Let Die, which, you know, I told you what happened there, wasn't the version I was expecting either. You know, so 2 I always was anticipating the most. And I also like the color scheme more. I kind of just like the darker purple, blue, cool color scheme. You know, maybe I'm just like a darker guy. Use Your Illusion 1 is like bright and hot. I like dark and cool. Dark and cool. Like my women. Let's do this. Use Your Illusion 2. Then and now. Civil War. Well, I already told you what I thought of Civil War because I had heard this song, I don't know, like almost a year or two, I think, like before Use Your Illusion came out. And I loved it and it was awesome and all the Slash solos were great. And this is something he wrote with Slash and Duff. Great song. Axel being the hymn. And it's a great song. Steven Adler plays drums on this. That's right. It's the only song on this album where Steven Adler's playing drums and you can hear the difference. Can hear the difference. I didn't fully appreciate it then, but I can hear the difference now. Yeah, I loved it, and I thought it was a great opener with that Cool Hand Luke. I had not seen the movie Cool Hand Luke at that time. In fact, it was this album and this song that put that movie under my radar. So it was like a year or two later, I finally saw it as a teenager for the first time, and I loved it. I loved Cool Hand Luke, even as a teenager. I grew to love it even more when I got older. So Civil War got me into Cool Hand Luke, and that's pretty cool. My baby Luke. Great movie if you haven't seen it. See Cool Hand Luke, goddammit. Civil War. I still love it. It's a great song. One Guns N' Roses' best song. I guess you could say it's like their anti-war song. Hey, nothing wrong with that. I don't like war either. Fuck war. Great song. This is an epic that sounds not try-hard, but just ambitious. And it's organic. And all the parts flow into each other. And it still sounds like a band, just an ambitious band that's expanding, you know? This is an amazing, amazing song. It's a classic. Love Civil War, and it's a great way to open the album. Although part of me almost thinks it works. Like I said, part of me almost would like Perfect Crime to open this. At the end of this video, I'm going to create a list of what I think my perfect tighter double Use Your Illusion would be. I'm going to add it as a graphic in post. I'm going to do that in post. All right, so if you're curious, it'll be there. And then we could all have our debates. And in the comment section, you can post what you think your perfect Use Your Illusion would be. I like it. It's like Choose Your Own Adventure. Choose Your Own Illusion. That should be fun. Second song on the album, 14 Years. Loved it then. Love it now. One of my favorite songs off both these two albums. I love 14 Years. And what do you know? It's an Izzy Stradlin song. That's right. It's another Izzy song. And he's singing lead vocals. Just like on the last album, Dustin Bones. The second song is an Izzy sung song. And 14 Years is the best one in my opinion. I would say when I was younger, Double Talk and Jive would have been my favorite Izzy song on Use Your Illusions. But now as an adult, a guy who's been knocked around by life for more than a decade. So I'd say 14 Years. Yeah, that's the gem. That's the greatest song I think Izzy ever wrote. And it's one of my favorite Guns N' Roses songs. And I say it's my second favorite song on either of these albums. That's right. Second favorite song on both albums. That's right. And that's the thing about this album. This album has a handful of songs that are my absolute favorite. Whereas Use Your Illusion 1 had like a handful of songs that were my favorite on one. Well, this album has a handful of songs that are my favorite on both of them. anything Guns N' Roses have done. 14 years. God, now this is really Stonesy. I like the piano riff, a good piano riff, and the hook of the song. Love the lyrics. Love the attitude. The chorus is so catchy. Now, this is a song that if Izzy had stayed in the band, I'm convinced would have been a single and would have had a video and would have been one of the earlier ones. Maybe the one they did right after November Rain, or at least after Yesterday's. I feel like this would have popped up eventually towards the middle section of when they were releasing singles. And it would have featured Izzy prominently. And it would have been great to see him get a single from this album. But he left the band, so they probably said scrap it. Now, there was a promo copy of this. I discovered this years later. This backs up my theory that this had potential to be a single and video, because there was a promo single and there is a cover of it, which they released to radio stations. So they obviously saw that this is a really catchy song. That chorus is so catchy and I love it. Axl comes in, sings great during the chorus, and this is a really important song because the lyrically, and I didn't realize that at the time, I thought it was about a relationship gone bad, like most of Izzy's and Axl's songs are. These guys have a lot of bad relationships, what can I say? Rock and roll. This song, actually, I found out years later, it's actually about Izzy and Axl. And once you realize that and listen to the lyrics, it makes a lot of sense. They had, at that point, when he wrote this song, they had known each other for 14 years, going back to Indiana. And it's about the 14 years of the ups and downs and their friendship and the struggling and the hustling and everything they needed to do to get to that point where they were when they were recording this follow-up to Appetite for Destruction. It's like you kind of see the writing on the wall. Like, essentially, this is a song where Izzy is singing to Axl, saying why Axl is such a pain in the ass. Like, he'll always have a special place in his heart for this man, and they achieved this awesome thing together, but he's just over it. It's like a divorce, you know, it's like Lennon McCartney, except for this is happening so soon. This is like Let It Be Beatles coming just for their second and third albums, you know, coming so soon in their career. And that's the thing, like, you can hear Izzy's like, he's just over it. And he's over it in this song, like, and it's just spells everything out for you. It's too bad, but at the same time, it's kind of like the most important Guns N' Roses song, because it's the Guns N' Roses song that really tells you why Guns N' Roses stopped. Because I'm sorry, this act that goes out and plays stadiums, to me, that's just like the Kiss end of the road tour. It's the same thing. It's like Scab Kiss. To me, it's not real Guns N' Roses without Izzy Stradlin. Sorry, just my opinion. If you got a different opinion, that's fine. We're all human beings, different opinions. But to me, this is the song that's kind of telling you why Guns N' Roses is ending before they really just started to warm up, man. It's crazy that such an amazing band ended so soon. Again, it must be really hard working and dealing with Axl. And especially when you've been dealing with him for 14 years. It's like any relationship, like a marriage coming to the end. You've been around with this person and you worked hard with this person and you had ups and downs with this person. And this song, it's a very powerful statement. And it's something, for my own personal reasons, I relate to and connect to. And I love this song. It's one of the greatest songs Guns N' Roses ever did. And it's really, really catchy on top of that as well. Hey, if you could be poignant and catchy at the same time, that's the goal. That's the gold standard for writing a goddamn pop rock song. Next, Yesterday's. I liked it then, like it now. Don't love it, didn't love it then, don't love it now. But I like it. It's a catchy enough song. Obviously, it's going to be a single. I knew it when I heard it. I was like, oh, this will be a single. Just like I thought with November Rain. But I definitely like it better than November Rain. It has a kind of a southern rock quality to it. It almost sounds like it could be like a Lynyrd Skynyrd ballad. It has that kind of vibe to it. I like it. It's not pretentious. Only 3 minutes, 14 seconds. Just a nice, catchy, melodic, vaguely southern rock ballad. Next is Knocking on Heaven's Door. Now, this is a song. I know my friend Michael Hampton hates this song. A lot of people hate this song, but then again, a lot of people love it too. I don't hate this song. I don't love it. It's not one of my favorite songs, but it doesn't bother me. And I gotta say, it's a much better cover than Live and Let Die. Guns N' Roses made this song their own. Unlike Live and Let Die. Like, I heard Live and Let Die, I was like, okay, well, you didn't do anything that Wings didn't already do and didn't do better. But this song is very different from the Bob Dylan's original, which is from the Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid soundtrack. Great Sam Peckinpah film. Loved it. Didn't see it back then. Great movie. It's great soundtrack if you like country music. This is country Bob Dylan, which I'm a fan of. I like his country period. And I liked his original song. But that song was very understated and simple and minimalistic. This song is, of course, very sprawling and epic and has a lot of different parts. And it sounds very Guns N' Roses. It sounds like what a cover should be when you take something and kind of make it your own. If this was on the Spaghetti Incident, it would have been the best song on the Spaghetti Incident. This was a song they were playing back live, even back during the Appetite days. So I guess, you know, they want to get it out of their system. It's a good cover. I like it. I like this kind of more retrospective vibe of this album. Use Your Illusion 1 is a little more like Appetite for Destruction goes to Broadway. You know, like half the songs sound like rockin', hard rockin', Appetite for Destruction type songs. Then the other half, like November Rain, Don't Cry, that's like the Broadway element. And I think even Coma to a degree. It's just like a heavy metal rock opera kind of thing. Whereas this is like the more kind of sophisticated, more mature, retrospective album of the two. And it would make sense that as I get older, I appreciate that even more. And, you know, Knocking on Heaven's Door has to deal with mortality, and they knew a lot of friends that were dying. And I think it's a good cover where they injected a lot of poignancy and a lot of creativity to it. Hated it live. Live, it's an abomination, not just because it just becomes some hokey sing-along song, but they do that Jamaican thing, that reggae part, when he goes, do it reggae, and then they go into a reggae part. Oh, it's horrible, horrible, horrible. Stay away from reggae, white boys. It's horrible. Hate it. Hate the Knocking on Heaven's Door reggae part. But this version does not have it. I don't even mind the phone call. So moving on to, oh, here we go. The worst song Guns N' Roses, real Guns N' Roses, ever did. And I don't count Spaghetti Incident as real Guns N' Roses, too. So this last album that real Guns N' Roses ever put out, by the way. Just so you know. Yeah, it's not my world. It's this song. Get in the Ring. It's an abomination. It's embarrassing. It's horrible. 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 Sounds like it should be on Use Your Illusion 1, and it'd be the worst song on Use Your Illusion 1. Ugh. That's not good. This definitely should not be on such a great album as Use Your Illusion 2. But you know what? I'll be honest with you. Eddie loved it. Yeah, Eddie thought it was badass. Eddie's like, yeah, fuck Bob Guccione Jr. I didn't even know who he was. I didn't know. I didn't know the whole history of Bob Guccione Jr. I was just on Axl's side. So I was like, anyone that Axl doesn't like must be an asshole. Took me years to discover, years, many, many years later, that in fact, Axl was most likely the asshole in this scenario. Coming against all the magazines that are ripping the kids off. Yeah, the same magazines that are putting your pictures all over it and talking about you all the time and creating all this publicity for you and all this controversy that you say you don't like, which is why people are always talking about you and running out and buying your records. Yeah, come on. Come on. Total poser shit. Poser shit. And they're all trying to sound tough on this song. Oh, God. And no wonder Izzy had nothing to do with this song. No way Izzy would have ever co-written a piece of shit like this. Slash, Duff, and Axl, they should be ashamed of themselves. In this whole wrestling ring thing and trying to act all tough. And that's the thing, too. Yeah, I'm sorry. I think Axl Rose was a very talented man who unfortunately had certain issues that kept him from totally fulfilling his promise as one of the great frontmen and a very good songwriter as well because of these issues and hangups that always held him back. It's the reason why he needed to take 14 years to record an album and just kept replacing band member after band member and guitarist after guitarist. It's the kind of Axl Rose that had Brian May from Queen play a guitar line on your album and then you replace him with some other dude. That Axl Rose is all here. You know, like I said, there's a little bit of that in Coma. There's a lot of that in November Rain. And there's way too much of it in Get in the Ring. Pretty much every bad quality of Axl Rose is in this song. Get in the Ring is sonically the foreshadowing. And it's going to be all gimmicky and all boo-hoo-hoo. Ooh, boo-hoo-hoo. I'm a big famous rock star and people are writing about me all the time. Boo-hoo-hoo. And then he says, get in the ring, motherfuckers, and tries to act like a tough guy. I saw Bob Guccione Jr. He was interviewed by MTV around this time, and he told Axl, hey, I'm a black belt. Come and get it. And you know what? Axl didn't go and beat his ass. And you know what? He didn't accept Vince Neil's challenge, too. Vince Neil, around this time period, challenged Axl Rose to a fight, as we all know, all us MTV kids. He challenged Axl to a fight, and Axl pussed out. He never showed up to fight Vince Neil. Probably a smart decision, because like Bob Guccione Jr., Vince Neil would have handed him his ass, because this was not the Vince Neil of today, or even the Vince Neil of 15 years ago. This was the Vince Neil feel-good era. He was ripped. Primal Scream era Vince Neil. He was ripped. He was in good shape. And this is a guy from Compton. Man, he would have beat the shit out of that skinny ginger from Indiana. Yeah, Axl's crazy. But you know what? Crazy was only going to go so far. Vince Neil would have beat him, in my opinion. So knowing that, that's the thing too. When Eddie was hearing this album and was listening to Get in the Ring, I didn't realize that Axl was just kind of a boo-hoo-hoo pussy that was not going to actually go and beat these people up. I assumed that Axl was a tough badass and he was going to beat up all these guys that he was calling out. I didn't know. It took me years to realize that Axl was fronting and that he wasn't a tough guy. And that he was just going to sit in a mansion for 15 years, popping meds and fucking around with an album that ended up being just mediocre at best. I didn't know that. I thought this guy was going to fucking save rock and roll and beat up everyone in his way. Because I was a young, dumb kid that didn't know. So I loved Get in the Ring and I thought it was awesome. But now I know it's an abomination. And I would hate to break little Eddie's heart and tell him that. But listen, Eddie, this song sucks. They're a bunch of posers. Izzy had nothing to do with this song. It's horrible. Throw it in the trash. It belongs in the trash. But at the same time, I can't say I want to live in a world where Get in the Ring doesn't exist. Because it's really funny. It's really amusing. But for all the wrong reasons. And I wish it was on Unusual Illusion 1 and not on Unusual Illusion 2. Because, really, this is one of only two songs that I think are full-out horrible. But anyway, I've talked more than enough about Get in the Ring. Keep this in the trash. Let's move on. Shotgun Blues. Filler. Not horrible like Get in the Ring. If anything, it sounds good after Get in the Rings. But, again, this is Axl Rose Ego. It's, like, because he played electric guitar on this, like, it had to be on the album. Like, it's just kind of a mediocre punk, kind of poppy punk rock song. It's all right. It would have been an all right B-side. I put this around in the same area as Don't Damn Me and Back Off Bitch. Decent B-side, but filler. You know, it doesn't really take away from the album, but it doesn't really add to it. Breakdown. Oh, Breakdown. Now, this is a song that you might think I'm going to hate because it's an Axl song. It's definitely an Axl song. I would say, for the most part, the last album was more Izzy, and this album's more Axl. But I love this song. Yeah, I love Breakdown. It's one of my favorite songs on the album, both these albums. I'd say it's top five songs. Like, pretty much all my favorite songs are on Use Your Illusion 2. And Breakdown, now this, to me, is a masterpiece. A goddamn masterpiece. It's songs like this that made me think that Axl Rose might be a genius. Might be a genius. And I thought that. I was defending him to a lot of people while he was working on Chinese Democracy. There was a period, before it became like cool to like Guns N' Roses again, there was a period where everyone laughed at Guns N' Roses and laughed at Axl Rose. And I had to stick up for this guy all the time. So there you go. I'm not some Axl basher. In fact, I was sticking up for him a lot. Even though I thought he pushed out with Vince Neil and Bob Guccione Jr., I still thought he was a genius and I was sticking up for him. It's like, it's all right that he's a pussy because he's a genius. All right. So I was sticking up for him and I thought Chinese Democracy was going to continue what he started with Use Your Illusion 2. Because by this point, Use Your Illusion 2, I was convinced was, you know, a masterpiece. And I still do. I think it's a flawed masterpiece, this album. Flawed masterpiece. Mainly because of Get in the Ring. And a couple things towards the end. But then when Chinese Democracy dropped, and I liked a couple songs on it. And we're like, okay, it's a decent enough solo Axl Rose album. It wasn't worth waiting 14 or 15 years for it. And it was kind of like, that's it. And then afterwards, he just became a nostalgic act. They just did the Use Your Illusion Vegas tour again. And he squeezed out Izzy. And I was like, oh, I'm done with you, Axl. I'm done with you. And then I've heard those newer songs, those new songs that Guns N' Roses released. Oh, they're horrible. Dog shit. Total dog shit. Worse than anything on Chinese Democracy. Horrible. So I'm starting to think that maybe Axl wasn't a genius after all. But he was very talented. Maybe genius is not a thing that, maybe it's a thing you got to work at. Maybe if he kept knocking out albums after this, maybe he would have became a genius. And maybe there's a little bit of genius on Use Your Illusion 2. At this point, this guy was hitting his stride. If there's any kind of genius to this man, it was emerging here. And he was hitting his stride. Breakdown is a goddamn masterpiece. It's a totally unique song. It has a southern rock element, kind of like Yesterday's. It's like a sprawling, epic southern rock song. Almost like a Civil War ballad at times. But then with ripping hard rock guitar solos. Great guitar solos from Slash. I'll give Slash some credit here. He does some great guitar solos. And Axl's vocals are amazing. You get all the different sounding Axls and the lyrics are great. It's a very unique song. And in the same way, like Elvis Presley and the Rolling Stones, both by the late 60s, early 70s, got to a point where kind of gospel, blues, and rock were all kind of in country. We're all kind of mixing into certain songs to the point where they just sounded like Stones or Elvis songs. Breakdown's a little like that. It just sounds like a Axl Rose moving on and trucking Civil War rock ballad. And It's a great song. If anything, I feel like Civil War and Breakdown should be maybe next to each other in the sequencing. I don't know, I'll work that out. I'm going to work out the sequencing later of this amazing Use Your Illusion album that I'm going to make up and put at the end of this video. I'm going to do that later. I'm going to need to drink a little bit for that. I need the power of the scotch, of the Johnny Walker Black, to create the perfect Use Your Illusion. So yeah, Breakdown. I love Breakdown. Even the little funky Breakdown part when they, Breakdown. I love it all. It's weird. It's a weird, awesome part of Axl's mad, ingenious mind. And I love everything about this song. Yeah, I get it. It's not for everyone, but it's definitely for me. And as I've gotten older, I've only grown to love Breakdown more and more and more. It's an awesome, dust yourself off. You gotta keep on trucking no matter what happens. And I love it. I find it very inspirational, this song. Beautiful and inspirational. Great job, Axl. I've given you some shit. I've given you some shit in this video. But you know what? Most people couldn't write a song as great as Breakdown. And your vocals are amazing on it. So good job, Mr. Rose. Good job. You're winning me back. You're winning me back. Okay. Then we got Stradlin. Yeah, good old Izzy Stradlin coming back for another great Izzy type of song. Pretty Tied Up. In parentheses, the pearls of rock and roll decadence. I love Pretty Tied Up. I loved it then. Love it now. Yes, great song, great rocker. There's a little bit of a sitar in the beginning, which I like. Creates a sexy, exotic atmosphere. But then it just kicks in, and it's a good old hard rocking, kind of Stonesy, Aerosmithy kind of Guns N' Roses song. Short of the piano and the sitar, this could have been on Appetite for Destruction. Great dirty lyrics. You notice how Izzy's kind of the dirtier one here. You know, he writes the songs that are a little more misogynistic and dirty, a little more like the Rolling Stones and Aerosmith. I love it. That's Guns N' Roses, man. Again, you notice how you didn't hear songs like Pretty Tied Up on Chinese Democracy? Maybe it's because Izzy's not doing stuff with him. Now, granted, I will say, Izzy, the Juju Hounds, he started to kind of become a little more middle of the road and not sleazy anymore. A little more basic middle of the road blues rock. But I'll tell you why. It's because he stopped doing drugs. The perfect combination is Izzy and drugs. Now, if the guy had to save his life and get off the drugs, that's great. You know, more power to you, Izzy. I'd rather have you live than write a bunch of great albums and then die. But I'll tell you what, for a few years there, from Appetite up to Use Your Illusion 2, when Izzy was wrestling with the drugs and being a shady guy, he was writing some of the best rock and roll of his generation. Izzy and drugs was a great combo. And that combo was the heart of Guns N' Roses. That's right. You remove Izzy and you remove the drugs from Izzy, you're removing the heart of Guns N' Roses, in my opinion. And the contrast from Breakdown to Pretty Tied Up, to me, that's it. That's the Mick Keith thing, man. That's the thing. The singer that's experiment with pop and different kinds of music. And Izzy's the guy that brings it down to down and dirty rock and roll. And that's what made Guns N' Roses, at a time, one of the greatest rock bands in history. For a few years there, for a few fleeting years, they were one of the best. And I love Pretty Tied Up. Like I said, loved it then, love it now. And then we're getting into, yeah, here we go. Here we go. I'm getting a little crazy. There's a little madness. That's right. Use Your Illusion 2, by the way. I didn't tell you about this. Do you know what the madness is? All right, the madness, it takes this. All right. Not doing this yet. I'm going to do this later. But it takes Johnny Walker Black Label. This is the ingredients. And this is the madness with a capital M. So you drink Johnny Walker Black. And you play Use Your Illusion 2. And this is a recipe for the madness. That's right. The madness happens. I get the madness when I listen to Use Your Illusion 2 and drink Johnny Walker Black. Especially once I start getting at this section. This part. Once we get into the Pretty Tied Up locomotive section of Use Your Illusion 2. If I'm drinking some scotch, woo, we're getting into the madness for sure. Okay, so here we go. Locomotive, the ultimate madness song, and my favorite Guns N' Roses song. That's right. Not just my favorite song on the Use Your Illusions, my favorite Guns N' Roses song, period. This is the greatest thing they ever did. And you know what? Hey, this is an exception. Exception to my whole Axl Izzy rule, this is actually Slash and Axl. So there you go. So there, you know, I don't got a bias. Hey, if you write a great song, I'll admit it. Slash wrote an awesome song, greatest song he ever co-wrote with Axl Rose. This is great. But again, I don't think he would have wrote a song that's great if Izzy Stradlin wasn't in the band. It's like how in the Beatles, George Harrison, you know, had to step up his game because he's writing songs with John and Paul. Slash steps up his game because Izzy Stradlin's in the band. And he totally fucking nails it with Locomotive, in parentheses, Complicity. Now, that's a little pretentious, that parenthesis, but I'll let it slide. Of course, we all just call it Locomotive. Amazing lyrics, amazing music, amazing guitar work. I think it's the greatest guitar work Slash has ever done. That riff, that chug-a-lugging riff, I love it. The song, it's heavy. It's funky, though. It has that, the drums. Matt Sorum actually does a decent job on this song. That's right. This is one of two songs where I think Matt Sorum's drumming is not necessarily any worse than what Steven Adler would have done. I think he's doing more or less what Steven Adler would have done. It has that kind of Rocket Queen groove to it. It's a good job. It's his second best drumming he does on this album, in my opinion. And that bass, of course, the beginning, it has that cool, like I said, it has that cool Kramer and Hamilton kind of groove to it. But then it goes full on psycho thrashy rock. It's kind of thrashy, but yet I remember when I first heard this, this song mesmerized me. Eddie loved this song too, and this was Eddie's favorite song. I don't know if it was Eddie's favorite Guns N' Roses song, but it was Eddie's favorite song from the Use Your Illusion albums. Locomotive blew me away. When Axl came in that weird, creepy kind of voice, ooh, I was like, this is weird, and I like it. That's when I discovered that I liked weird things. This song, just still to this day, I call it psychoerotic thrash cock rock. It's amazing. Amazing song, and it just builds and builds, never gets boring. All the guitar solos are great, never boring, like I think some of the guitar solos in Coma are. And then it gets to that wonderful coda when the piano comes in, Slash, you know, gets all slow and sexy sounding, and then it does the build up. If Love Is Blind, I Guess I'll Buy a Cane. Love the lyrics, love the vibe, the atmosphere, it's dark. They really just nailed this groove. Actually, I didn't realize it then because I didn't hear it then, but this ending has almost got kind of a Goathead Soup kind of vibe, which I love. It has that dark early 70s kind of vibe to it. I love this song. I could just go on and on about how awesome Locomotive is. The greatest thing that the combination of Axl and Slash in a band that also has Izzy Stradlin in it, this is the best thing that they ever did. This is a song I also thought could have been a single. I think a lot of people would have liked this if this had a epic video, and definitely think Locomotive would have made more of a splash than Garden of Eden. But anyway, awesome song. My favorite Guns N' Roses song, period. Moving on to So Fine. All right, So Fine. I don't hate So Fine. I liked it then. I like it now. Wasn't one of my favorites then, but I did get a kick out of Duff singing. Yeah, I like when he says, I'm going to reach out and grab one for you, baby. Sounds like this goofball trying to sound like he's on a Replacements album or something. Not that great of a singer. Again, I feel that this song would have been a little bit better on the last album. I feel like it's a little too throwaway for two. Doesn't have that substance, especially after you hear a song like Locomotive. You kind of want to go right into Estranged. You know, that's all I'm going to say. It's like So Fine is like a hangnail between Locomotive and Estranged. Not a bad song. You know, but it's kind of, I would say it's B-side material. It'd be cool little B-side, or be better tonally, work better with the last album. But it definitely should not be between Locomotive and Estranged. Definitely not. It's an all right little weird punk ballad. It's kind of like a ballad, but then it's a little punky. I don't know. Definitely one of the weaker songs on this album, but not horrible. Then we move on to the masterpiece that should follow Locomotive, Estranged. Here we go. Now, for all those people that love November Rain, that's fine. More power to you. But that song doesn't do anything for me. Estranged does everything to me. One of my favorite songs on this album. If we're talking ballads, yeah, this is my favorite Guns N' Roses ballad. This song is a masterpiece. Just Axl Rose. So again, I have to say, Axl, when he really pulls in deep, he can really pull out a masterpiece. And this song is a masterpiece. This is like Zeppelin level mastery, in my opinion. Axl's a really talented guy. And that's the thing. You hear a song like Estranged, and you think, he might be some kind of genius. Axl Rose might be a genius. And you hear like Street of Dreams on Chinese Democracy, and you go, maybe not. Maybe he's just a cornball writing Broadway-type music. I don't know. But Estranged doesn't sound like Broadway, like November Rain. This is a dark, straight-up, epic power ballad. Power ballad in the truest sense of the word power. It's powerful in all the different parts, and it has a sensuality to it. The song just takes you on a journey. Slash, this is, I think, his second best guitar work on this album after Locomotive. Amazing guitar work. But the thing is, as great as Slash is as a guitarist here, this thing afterwards, after Guns N' Roses, he never did anything that sounded even remotely like this. You know, that's the thing, is some people, that it's about this collective, it's about this group of people. and musicians working together that brought things out of each other. Like, I heard the story that Axl Rose, like, this Sweet Child of Mine riff was something that Slash was just noodling around with in the studio, and he would have just let it go, but Axl was like, hey, stop, that thing, do that thing before the song. And I feel like Estranged is a thing like that. In the liner notes, Axl doesn't give Slash credit for writing the song, but he gave him a special thanks. Thanks for coming up with all these really great hooks. They're amazing hooks. I almost feel like Slash should have a co-writing credit on this song, because those hooks are like a big character of the song itself. But it's amazing. It's an amazing collaboration. This is what's so frustrating. Almost, if there was any hope for this band post-Izzy, it's most suggested by Locomotive and Estranged. These two songs say that, hey, Axl and Slash together maybe could become this thing that people act like Axl and Slash are. But they didn't do it. They did a shitty covers album afterwards, and then they did an even shittier cover of that Rolling Stones song, Sympathy for the Devil. And then the band breaks up, and, you know, and now they're, it's too late now. But that's what I'm saying. If they had kind of, right then and there, if they just went into a studio and didn't do the spaghetti incident, and actually built on Locomotive and Estranged, then Axl and Slash, maybe there could have been a Guns N' Roses without Izzy. Maybe I'd be eating my words with all my Izzy worship. Maybe they could have taken Guns N' Roses to even higher heights. But they didn't do that. So that's the thing. All I know is that they did great shit with Izzy, and then without Izzy, they didn't do great shit. But man, Locomotive and Estranged, that's where there's not just hype. There was something there, which Axl and Slash did with these two songs. And Estranged is one of the greatest ballads ever. Dark, meaty, passionate, sensual song. This does not feel insincere at all. This feels very sincere. This doesn't feel like about a younger Axl Rose wrote trying to sound deep and poignant and sentimental and trying to be like Elton John. This is Axl actually really expressing himself as a unique artist. And of course, it didn't do as well as November Rain. And of course, it was like destined to not do as well as November Rain, regardless of the silliness of the video with the aircraft carrier and dolphins. And it was an absurd video. The video is almost as absurd as Get in the Ring. But this song is a masterpiece. It's only gotten better with age. It's one of my favorite ballads ever written. This song means a lot to me. I love it, and it's great. Maybe Axl, at least for a fleeting moment, was a genius. Moving on to another amazing song. I really wish So Fine wasn't there. If So Fine wasn't there, you would have had Locomotive, Estranged, and You Could Be Mine in a row. Whoa! You Could Be Mine, one of the greatest Guns N' Roses songs ever. Definitely a top 10 song for me. One of their best songs. That's the thing. This is why Use Your Illusion 2 is my favorite Guns N' Roses album. Civil War, 14 Years, Breakdown, Pretty Tied Up, Locomotive, Estranged, You Could Be Mine. Of course, this has got to be my favorite Guns N' Roses album. Oh man, You Could Be Mine, amazing. An amazing rocking song. And of course, this is back to the Axl Izzy thing. This is a song Axl and Izzy wrote together. And again, of course, with Izzy, it's going to have a grimy, down and dirty, kind of Stonesy Aerosmith thing picked up to 11. This is the other song along with Locomotive where I think Matt Sorum actually does a decent job. And if anything, his kind of robo-drumming vibe kind of fits the song with those fills in the beginning and with the whole Terminator 2 crossover. This is like the one song where I think actually he might have pulled it off better than Steven Adler. Although for the most part, I would still prefer Steven Adler on this album. But Matt Sorum does a good job on this song. I will give him credit for this. It's all working. There's a great groove. Even though it's an Izzy Axl song, the whole band is adding a lot to this song. You know, Duff's bass line, Slash's licks. They're all coming together just like they did throughout Appetite for Destruction. And it's a classic. Of course, this is one of their most popular songs. It deserves to be. It was a great lead-off single. Makes a lot of sense as a lead-off single. It's great. It's awesome. I like the placement. Some people think this could be an album opener. It kind of works. I think it's kind of an obvious album opener. I kind of like it towards the end. In fact, I think this should have been the end of the album. That would have been a cool way to rock. You do the big power ballad of Strange, and then you bring it home with a straight up Guns N' Roses rocker, You Could Be Mine. And with that last scream of Axl's, that powerful last scream, that would have been an awesome way to end Use Your Illusion 1 and 2. That would have been perfect. To me, when I do this my ultimate Use Your Illusion thing, which I'm going to add at the end of this episode, You Could Be Mine will definitely end it. I'm going to tell you now, because it should have ended it. But now, unfortunately, it continues with two songs that you definitely don't need. Don't Cry, Alternate Lyrics. All right. I guess lyrically, maybe it's a little more sophisticated, you know, but if anything, I go with the first one, even though I'm not crazy about that first one, but the melody is a little stronger, I think, in the first one. The verses always sounded a little awkward to me. They didn't really flow well. And it's just the same song with just a different vocal part. The music's all the same. And so it's really redundant. And it's just not, I mean, this is the very definition of filler, where they just got another song with just alternate lyrics. Whenever you see the parentheses alternate, that's like a bonus track on a CD that I want to take off the album, you know? And this is just like that. Maybe this could have been a B-side for Don't Cry. But this idea that this should have been on the album, this is total filler. No reason to be on this. And just like with the other Don't Cry, I like the original demo version better. So throw this in the trash. Don't need it. And then, of course, probably the most controversial song on this, on the Use Your Illusions, My World. That's right. It's only a minute and 24 seconds. And it's the industrial techno song that apparently the other band members didn't even know Axl was putting this on. So that's another foreshadowing of things to come. That Axl, and look at the balls on this guy, he decides to do this jerk-off industrial thing on his own, and then he puts it on the album without talking to the other band members about it. Didn't talk to Izzy or Slash or Duff about that. Very uncool. Very uncool, Axl. You don't do that shit. And for this piece of shit, it's horrible. I admit, Eddie liked it. Yeah, Eddie thought it was cool. Wasn't one of his favorite songs, but he just thought it was dirty and weird and kind of fucked up. So his adolescent mind, he kind of thought, cool, it's weird, it's fucked up. So he liked it. I liked Revolution 9 a lot when I was a teenager too. Although Revolution 9 is better than this shit. But this is essentially the Revolution 9 of this album. It is short, I'll give it that. Should have never got past Axl Rose's computer. Or Cakewalk, whatever he was using back then. Should have never got past that. Just because he liked suddenly got on a Nine Inch Nails kick or something. It's lame. And this shows you this trendy side that Axl had, where he starts to try to be cool all the time. He's trying to be industrial and wanting to change the sound of Guns N' Roses just for the sake of it. And, you know, it's all poser shit. If Estranged and Locomotive and You Could Be Mine, you know, that's real Axl Rose. In My World, it's the poser shit. And it's the kind of shit that always kills a great band when the band members get too obsessed with seeming hip and different and cutting edge. And there's progress. Like, Estranged felt like organic progress. Locomotive sounded like organic progress. My World sounds like contrived, forced progress. And that's kind of the whole problem why he was fucking around with Chinese Democracy for so long. Because every year or two, he needed to change it. He's like, oh, no, music's different now. I gotta change it. Like, if Chinese Democracy came out in the late 90s, it was gonna be a total industrial-sounding album. But he had to change that because that wasn't the thing so much in a few years. So he kept having to change it, and that's the thing, kept chasing trends. Instead of just knocking out albums like a real rock and roller and like a real artist, art should reflect the time that it was created in. But the time shouldn't be a shackle to it, holding it back from just being. And that's the thing, Axl Rose shackled himself as an artist, and he destroyed a band, one of the greatest bands ever in rock music, in this pursuit to be hip and edgy, and it became a black hole, which nothing could escape it, until all you had was Chinese Democracy and a bunch of people going, eh, and then suddenly he's doing a reunion tour with Slash next to him, and it's fake Guns N' Roses as far as I'm concerned. So that was a sad fate for this band. But man, there was a time where they could have had it all. And Use Your Illusion 2, especially its best parts of it, definitely signify how they could have been truly like a Rolling Stones or Led Zeppelin or one of those great bands. They had it in their grasp, but hey, you know, that's how it goes. And you know, to some people, I think in some ways, the fact that Guns N' Roses imploded kind of and wasn't around for decades kind of, I guess, made him kind of like more of a novelty, and people were very nostalgic for them. And I think that's one of the big reasons why those stadium shows were so successful. If Guns N' Roses had kind of just gotten mediocre and been around a lot, they wouldn't have been so special. Ideally, it would have been great if they stuck around and were awesome. But as you heard from Spaghetti Incident, that wasn't the case. They weren't going to stick around and be awesome. They would have just got worse, unfortunately. And they should have kept getting better and better. You know, at least for 10 years, a really, truly great band has a 10-year run, as far as I'm concerned. And Guns N' Roses imploded before they got to that 10-year run. But hey, I do love Use Your Illusion 2, even with its few glaring flaws. And I like Use Your Illusion 1. And I think together, the two of them, they could have been a slightly scaled back, tighter double album that, to me, deserved to be a double album. So for the most part, a pretty strong statement from GNR, and I dig it, and that's it. That's all I got to say. The Eddie back then and the Edwin now, they disagree on a few things, but for the most part, we kind of feel the same way about these albums. And like I said, at the end of the video, I'm going to put up my ideal Use Your Illusions. All right, I'll put that up. So if you like this video, check out some of my other videos, and also subscribe. Subscribe down below. I've never asked people to do that before. The other day, a guy was saying, hey, you should have more subscribers because your videos are awesome, and I appreciate that. And you know what? I agree with him. My videos are awesome. Subscribe to that shit. If you've been watching and you haven't been subscribing, hey, don't be a guy that just watches. Interact. Subscribe. Leave comments. Let's do this. Let's get something going on here, all right? Don't just be a guy watching. Get involved, and help me out. Subscribe. Let's get those numbers up. Also, I'd like to announce that if you dig hearing me rambling on about music, well, I am starting a podcast, a new podcast with one of my rock and roll brothers, Eric Jordan. Some of you might know him as Eric Jordan, RMCP. He's a longtime member of the RMCP Army. Young man, but he's been hanging there for a long time. And Eric Jordan's great. He had a great podcast called The Metal Dungeon that he started. It's going to be an expansion of The Metal Dungeon, which we are calling the Rock All Over You podcast. We're planning to do our first episode next week. The premiere episode is going to be a review of this band, but not this album. It's going to be Dokken, Back for the Attack. It's going to be me and Eric, and usually a revolving guest. One other guy who's going to be like another YouTuber or podcast guy or just a fan, like someone that we talk to that we get along with that likes talking about music. Maybe it can be you. For the most part, we're going to focus on hard rock and heavy metal albums for the most part. Occasionally, like my own videos, we might occasionally throw a curveball. So there you go. The Rock All Over You podcast will be available on Podbean, Apple Podcasts, and Spotify. That's where you can find the Rock All Over You podcast. It's going to be awesome. So there you go. That was my Use Your Illusion video. Check out that podcast, subscribe, and here comes my track listing for what I think the tighter, perfect Use Your Illusion would have been. There you go. Rock on, and Happy New Year.